Back around 2002, Target came to a statistician with a question in which the answer could potentially make the company millions of dollars. They asked, using only computers, can you determine which customers are pregnant even if they don't want us to know? And from then on, statistician Andrew Poole was in search of an algorithm to do just that. What he did was analyze the shopping patterns of expectant mothers and notice some common behaviors, like an increase in lotion purchases, loading up on vitamins, and more stuff that I know nothing about. And he uses information to not only determine which customers were likely pregnant, but what their expected due date was. And after developing his mathematical model, the statistician had a list of hundreds of thousands of women who were likely pregnant, along with their expected due date and what trimester they were in. And from then on, Target could send coupons at just the right time over the next several months, and even after the baby was born. Now, although Target was cautious about following secrecy laws, it still might turn women away if all of a sudden they started getting coupons for like cribs and diapers and other related items when they didn't in fact tell the company that they were pregnant. So what Target did was just sprinkle these items in along with some other unrelated products when coupons arrived so it would seem more natural. But about a year after creating this algorithm, something happened though, and this is where it gets interesting. One day, a man walked into a Minnesota Target demanding to see a manager. He was very angry. And apparently what had been going on was Target was sending coupons for things like diapers and cribs and other related items to this guy's high school daughter. And he was very upset about this. He was saying things like, "Are you guys trying to encourage her to get pregnant?" And the manager didn't really know what was going on. He, of course, apologized. And a few days later, the manager called the dad back to apologize again. But this time, the dad wasn't so much angry, but a little more embarrassed. And I think you guys know where this is going. On the phone, the dad said, "I in fact owe you an apology. There's been some things going on around here that I haven't been fully aware of. And in fact, my daughter is pregnant and she's due in August." So yes, this statistical algorithm figured out that this girl was pregnant before her dad even knew about it. That right there is the power of statistics. And we're just getting started. In 1964, an elderly woman was walking home from grocery shopping when she was all of a sudden pushed to the ground and had her purse stolen. Now, she was able to get a glimpse of the thief and saw a blonde woman in a ponytail who then fled the scene. Then there was also a man nearby who heard the screaming and saw the woman run into a yellow car that was driven by a black man who had a beard and a mustache. And yes, this is all needed for the story, by the way. A few days after the incident, police ended up catching Janet Collins and her husband Malcolm, who matched all the descriptions given by the witnesses. They were then charged with the crime and put in front of a jury. Now, since most of the evidence that could be provided for this was just from the victim and the man who saw the event and what they both witnessed, they brought in a mathematician as well to help prove the guilt of this couple. This mathematician calculated the probability of just randomly selecting a couple that was innocent but also happened to share all of these characteristics that were observed by the witnesses. Based on data, the mathematician came up with these numbers, and assuming independent events, we can multiply them all together to find the joint probability that they'd all happen to apply to an innocent couple. Turns out there was less than a 1 in 12 million chance that this random couple, who just happened to fit all those descriptions, was innocent. So the jury returned a guilty verdict. And this is actually a very famous case in terms of using statistics in the courtroom. Another quick example is that of Sally Clark, who was found guilty of murdering her two infant sons back in the 90s. Her first son died suddenly in 1996 due to unknown causes, so it was assumed it was a case of SIDS, or sudden infant death syndrome. But about a year later, she gave birth to her second son, who was then found dead 8 weeks after his birth, again of unknown causes. So after this happened and it was reported, the police ended up arresting her and her husband on suspicion of murder. During the trial, a pediatrician professor testified that the chance of two infants dying due to SIDS at around the same time relative to their birth was about 1 in 73 million. And again, 1 in 73 million is way beyond a reasonable doubt. So it was more likely this was an event of shaking or smothering or whatever. And Sally Clark was found guilty and sentenced to life in prison. So you can see, statistics has a lot of power in our world, whether it be advertising, criminal cases, and so on. But what's also really powerful and way easier to do is lie, mislead, and misinform using statistics. And you don't even have to use wrong data to do this. I mean, I've already done that multiple times in this video. I'm going to talk about that soon. So yes, this next part is for all you people who comment on videos before watching the entire thing. because there is more I'm going to say. But let's start off light though. In 2007 in the UK, an ad was released for Colgate that claimed the classic 80% of dentists recommend Colgate. It wasn't long before the Advertising Standard Authority of the UK ordered they abandon this claim because although it was true, they knew people would not really understand what it meant. The study that was done allowed dentists to answer with more than one toothpaste. So like dentist one might say, I recommend Colgate, Crest, or Oral-B. Dentist two might say Colgate, Crest, or Sensodyne, and similar for dentist three, four, and five. In this scenario, 80% of dentists do recommend Colgate, that is true. But 100% of dentists recommend Crest in this hypothetical, and 80% recommend Oral-B as well. All of these numbers are factual, and you can make an advertisement with any of these claims. But again, we know people would not understand what they really meant. Now, for this next part, I'm gonna ask you guys a question. If, let's say hypothetically, the high school dropout rates of a certain country go from 5% one year to 10%, is that a 5% increase or a 100% increase? Because if you're at 5% and you add 5, you get to 10%, obviously. But if you're making, let's say, $5 an hour and you get a 100% raise, you'll be at $10 an hour. So which one of these is it? And I'm sure many of you are saying this seems like a pointless question. Yes, you do add 5 to get to 10, but the physical amount of people who are dropping out would be increasing by 100%. Well, in the spirit of this video, let's ask something else. Which one of these paints a more accurate picture? Like, if one of these was posted in the New York Times or on Forbes or whatever, which one tells the people more about what's going on? And I'm actually curious what you guys have to say about that, because I think we're gonna hear different answers from different people. But for this next part, I think we're all gonna agree. What if, hypothetically, the dropout rates are 1 in 1,000,000 people, and then the next year they go to 2 in 1,000,000 people? So that's 0.0001% to 0.0002%. A difference of, again, 0.0001. But that's also a 100% increase in the physical amount of people dropping out. So which one of these two headlines do you think paints a better picture? Well, again, we might hear different answers, but I think we can agree the 100% makes it seem like a worse problem than it is. Like if 5 people in the whole nation are dropping out and the next year 10 people do, I wouldn't necessarily call that an epidemic just yet. Now, using numbers like this in a misleading way is actually not hypothetical because it happened a few decades ago in the UK, but not with college dropout rates, but rather a birth control pill. In 1995, the UK Committee on Safety of Medicines issued a warning that a certain type of birth control pill increased the risk of life-threatening blood clots by 100%. What that actually meant was that with the older second-generation pill, about 1 in 7,000 women developed a blood clot, whereas with the new pill, about 2 in 7,000 women developed a blood clot. So yes, the physical amount of women receiving a blood clot did go up by 100%, that is true. But if we dig just a little deeper, we see with the older pill was about 0.014%, whereas with the new pill, it was about 0.028%, which hardly seems worthy of a breaking news alert. But articles were posted about this misleading statistic, and as a result, naturally tens to hundreds of thousands of women stopped taking this birth control pill. Fast forward 1 year, and that scare was blamed for 13,000 unwanted pregnancies, many of which were teenage pregnancies. A lot of teenage pregnancy stories in this video. Moving on, do you guys actually know head lice is good for your health? Seems pretty stupid, right? But people actually thought this at one point. And that brings us to the part of this video titled correlation or causation, or both. Remember, it's usually very easy to determine that two things are correlated from a statistical test, but causation is a completely different thing that isn't so easy to spot. Yet people are very quick to assume that A causes B just because A is correlated to B. Sometimes the logic can be stupidly obvious, like fast-moving wind turbines are positively correlated to fast wind. As one goes up, the other goes up. But does that mean that fast-moving wind turbines cause fast wind? Well, obviously not, it's the other way around. But in many cases, it isn't this obvious. Like, what if I said that kids who watch violent TV shows are more violent themselves? Does this mean that those shows cause kids to be more violent? I mean, that could be possible and definitely would be an immediate thought for many people. But what if kids who are more violent just happen to watch more violent TV shows? That also seems perfectly reasonable. So we can't just jump to conclusions too early, even though that's what many people would probably do. Or in the Middle Ages, Europeans saw that people who had head lice were normally healthy, whereas people who were sick rarely ever had head lice. As a result, they assumed that lice would cause people to be more healthy, when in reality, head lice is very sensitive to body temperature. So if people had a fever or anything like that, the head lice would find another host. Then on this subject, we have the third cause fallacy, where two correlated events actually don't cause each other at all, but it's rather a third thing causing both. For example, ice cream sales do not cause an increase in heat strokes, nor the other way around, even though they are correlated. Hot weather is instead the cause of both of them. Or for the past several decades, atmospheric CO2 has increased along with obesity levels. So does one cause the other? Well, no. Richer populations tend to eat more and also produce more CO2. And sometimes they can just be really unclear what's causing what. Like a while back, they found that students who smoke cigarettes get lower grades. And that could mean smoking causes lower grades. Or maybe it means that getting bad grades causes smoking. Maybe the added stress that comes along with lower grades increases the chance that a student will pick up that first cigarette. That also seems like a reasonable explanation. Or it could be a variety of third factors is actually responsible for both. So even when looking at a statistical test with accurate numbers, it's pretty crazy how far you can still be from the truth. Next, we have a story that will probably have people making assumptions really early. In the 1970s, someone noticed that Berkeley was accepting 44% of male applicants to their graduate school, but only 35% of female applicants. Now, right there, half the internet's like, well, say no more. But only 35% of female applicants. Here we go. That was an actual unedited clip of everyone on the internet. Now, these numbers that we saw are true, but very misleading. When you look at how male and female applicants applied to each program within the graduate school, the assumed bias not only goes away, but kind of flips. Look closely here. In this row, you see there was a high acceptance rate for the program. In fact, women had a much higher acceptance rate, but still overall it was high for everyone. However, way more men applied to this one, whereas more women applied to these programs down here with much lower acceptance rates. So since a higher percentage of women were applying to these programs with higher rejection rates, the overall acceptance of women would be lower guaranteed, even though they are in fact slightly favored across a couple of departments. So either of these headlines could be published with the necessary stats to back them up. And all you gotta do is pick which one you wanna use, toss the other, throw that into an article, put it in bold right on the top, put the cleverly selected statistics down below it to back it up, and you've got yourself a story. This here was an example of Simpson's paradox, where looking at data as a whole tells a totally different story than grouping the data appropriately, which I'm sure many of you know, but I had to include it here. You guys remember the story of the blonde woman who robbed the elderly lady? Well, like I said, this is a famous case. But not for the use of statistics, but rather the misuse of statistics in the courtroom. This was a classic example of the prosecutor's fallacy. Now, this fallacy comes up when people assume that the probability of A given B is the same as the probability of B given A, which I'm sure many of you know is not usually true from this equation. Like, if I said behind this curtain is an animal with four legs, that's the given. What is the chance that it's a dog? Well, you'd probably do some thinking like, well, it could be a dog, it could be a cat, it could be a cheetah, it could be a lot of other things. And if you had to come up with a number, you might say 1 in 100, 1 in 1,000, or whatever. But if instead I said behind this curtain is a dog, that's the given, what's the chance that it has 4 legs? Well, that's almost a guarantee because most dogs have 4 legs. So you see, switch the given and the question at hand, and the probability can change by a lot. So now let's look at what I said earlier. Turns out there was less than a 1 in 12 million chance that this random couple who just happened to fit all those descriptions was innocent. So the jury returned a guilty verdict. This here was wrong. The stats actually showed us that given an innocent couple, the odds that they fit the descriptions was 1 in 12 million. But then I said what the jury had also assumed, that if you switch the given and the question at hand, the probability stays the same, which we just saw can be very wrong. this left side should make sense. Like, if I just grabbed a random couple out of a mall, that's the given, there's a very small chance all of these would apply to them. But this is the false assumption that is the prosecutor's fallacy. We're told or given, hey, here's a couple that fits all those descriptions. If maybe 10 people in the entire city fit all of those, given a random one, there's a 1 out of 10 chance that they're guilty, or a 9 in 10 chance of being innocent, not 1 in 12 million. And remember Sally Clark, who was found guilty of murdering her two children? This is also a famous case of the misuse of statistics. Turns out bacterial tests had actually been withheld that would reveal more specific information than a simple multiplication of two probabilities, which didn't tell the full story at all. Like, it assumed that the two events were independent of each other, when genetic or environmental factors could have definitely been at play. Like I said, Sally was found guilty and sentenced to life in prison, but she only served 3 years when the convictions were finally overturned in early 2003. Up until then though, Sally Clark was widely criticized in the press as a child murderer, and she was never able to recover mentally from the false accusation. A few years after her release, she developed psychiatric problems and died in her home from alcohol poisoning in 2007. I'm going to repeat that for everyone who didn't follow it. A woman lost two of her children due to natural causes, was accused of murdering them, was put on trial and found guilty due to a misuse of statistics, spent 3 years in prison, and even after her release was not able to recover mentally and died just about 4 years later. If you guys don't find that story insane, then I don't know what to tell you. And actually, the result of this case prompted the Attorney General to order a review of hundreds of other similar cases. Now, because I don't want that to be where we end this video, let's look at one more classic misuse of statistics. This one has to do with how data is represented, and it often involves bar graphs that don't have zero as their baseline. For example, Fox News once showed a chart detailing the numbers of what would happen if the Bush tax cuts expired. Do you guys see a problem? Yeah, it starts at 34% at the bottom, making a not even 15% increase look like a few hundred percent. In reality, the chart should look like this. Or take the Terry Schiavo case that occurred about 2 decades ago, which involved a debate of whether a feeding tube should be removed from a woman in an irreversible vegetative state. During that time, CNN posted this graph detailing which political parties agreed with the courts. It seems like Democrats supported the decision significantly more, but because the baseline is not zero, it appears way different than it should. This is what the actual graph would look like. Or in 2015, the White House published a tweet about the increase in students receiving high school diplomas with an extremely misleading graphic. They made around a 10% increase look like nearly 200%. Or in music, there was a chart release showing views between top artists that made Drake look like he was ahead by a large margin, when in fact it was about a 5% lead. Now, I'm guessing the comments on this video will be rather interesting, but remember, these were cherry-picked events, and it's not like everything I said paints the full picture either. I just find it interesting that these numbers can change the way we think about a person. They can peek into some of the most intimate moments of our lives based on our grocery list. They can make very trivial events seem very serious and vice versa, and you don't even need to use wrong numbers for this. But hopefully this showed just how not cut and dry math and statistics can be in the real world, outside of a school setting especially. And with that, I'm gonna end that video there. If you guys enjoyed, be sure to like and subscribe. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter and join the Major Prep Facebook group for updates on everything. Hit the bell if you're not being notified, share, comment, and all those other YouTube words. And I will see you guys in the next video.